Hi, folks. If we could take a seat, we're going to go ahead and get started. That was fast. That's great. Good afternoon. My name is Naran Khan, and I'm a program officer here at the Ford Foundation. I especially want to welcome those of you who are joining us for the first time. We are proud to be hosting this conversation because so many of the topics we'll cover are issues we think about and work on every day. As a social justice foundation focused on fighting inequality, it's not surprising that we find ourselves engaged in human rights, accountability and transparency, peace and conflict, social justice storytelling, and investigative journalism. We rarely hear from the civilians living in the conflict zones where the U.S. wages war, and today we have the opportunity to do just that. Basim Razzo was a resident of Mosul, Iraq, in September of 2015, when a U.S. airstrike targeted his home, killing his wife, daughter, brother, and nephew. Gravely injured in the strike, Basim snuck out of ISIS territory to get medical care in Turkey. He returned to Iraq in 2016 and set out on a quest to get justice, not just for compensation, official recognition of his loss, and an answer as to why his family was targeted. Basim's story was chronicled in The Uncounted, an on-the-ground investigation published by Azmat Khan and Anand Gopal in the New York Times Magazine last November. Investigating a sample of more than 100 airstrikes across northern Iraq, Azmat and Anand revealed how the U.S.-led air war in Iraq has been significantly less precise than claimed, and how Iraqi civilians like Basim are coping. Based on ground investigation, hundreds of interviews, an embed at a U.S. airbase, and other reporting, they conducted the first systematic ground-based sample of airstrikes in Iraq since the anti-ISIS air war began in 2014. They found that 1 in 5 of the coalition strikes they identified resulted in a civilian death, a rate more than 31 times acknowledged by the coalition. They also revealed a consistent failure by the coalition to investigate claims properly or to keep records that make it possible to investigate the claims at all. Perhaps most importantly, they found a system in which Iraqis are considered guilty until proven innocent. Those who survived the airstrikes remained marked as possible ISIS sympathizers, with no discernible path to clear their names. The investigation was awarded the 2018 National Magazine Award for Reporting and the 2018 Overseas Press Club Award for Magazine Reporting. Lawmakers, former government officials, and editorial pages have reflected on these results and called for action. It is indeed Basim's courage and tenacity that inspired the investigation and grounded the story. And so, we are honored to have with us today Basim Razzo, a resident of Mosul, Iraq, where he owned a pharmacy and was an accountant manager for a Chinese multinational telecom company. Basim is a graduate of Western Michigan University, where he received a Bachelor of Science degree in Industrial Engineering in 1988. Basim will be joined by Azmat in conversation. Azmat Khan is an investigative reporter, a contributing writer for the New York Times Magazine, and a Future of War Fellow at New America and Arizona State University. Her accountability investigations have taken her to conflict zones including Iraq, Afghanistan, and Pakistan. She received an MST from Oxford University, a BA from the University of Michigan, and she also studied at the American University in Cairo. This is Basim's first live public conversation in the United States. I'll add on a personal note that I've heard about Basim and his story from Azmat over the past 2 years, and we've been in touch online. I feel like I know him already, though I met him in person for the first time this afternoon. I am so honored to host this conversation. Please join me in welcoming Basim Razzo and Azmat Khan to the Ford Foundation.
Naran, thank you so much for that incredible introduction. and to the Ford Foundation for hosting us today, and mostly to you, Basim, for coming, for being here, and taking the time to tell your story.
I'm so happy and honored to be here, and I'm grateful to all of the people who have helped me tell my story to the millions of Americans. Thank you, Azmat.
So before we begin the conversation, I just wanted to pull up a few slides and very quickly introduce you to this anti-ISIS air war, which began in August of 2014. And I want to take you sort of through this view from the air. Since August of 2014, the United States has led a coalition of countries that have been bombing ISIS targets in Iraq and Syria. And if we could just pull up the presentation. Is it ready? Oh, perfect. Okay. So if you take a look here, you can see how much territory was taken over by ISIS in Iraq and Syria in 2015. It's the light red color that's represented on this map. If you look at the dark red color, you'll see that the territory that is still held by ISIS today. So there's very clearly, over the last several years, been an incredible, not just a swift taking of territory, but of retaking of it. And a large reason for that has been the anti-ISIS air war. So it's known as Operation Inherent Resolve. And over the last several years, the United States has conducted more than 14,000 airstrikes in Iraq, more than 15,000 in Syria. It's dropped more than 106,000 bombs, and according to US officials, has claimed as many as 70,000 ISIS fighters, while, also according to the government, only killing 841 civilians. Now, if these numbers are correct, you're looking at a civilian death rate of 0.6%, less than 1%. This would be unprecedented in the history of modern warfare. But it would also be incredibly difficult to believe when you go to the ground. And so what we want to do is just show you, you know, one of the sort of airstrikes that the government will publish online. You can see here, this was a video that was uploaded to YouTube. It says, coalition airstrike destroys a Daesh, also known as ISIS, VBIED facility near Mosul, Iraq, on the 20th of September, 2015. You can see in before and after satellite imagery that this airstrike hit these what looked to be two structures very accurately, destroying nothing else in its midst. There is the kind of technological precision these days, we are told, to target a building and hit maybe just one room full of ISIS fighters. This is the view from the ground. But fortunately, we're here, joined by Basim today, to get an understanding of the view from the, that is the view from the air. We're joined by Basim today to get a view from the ground. And so I want to just start, Basim, with your perception, you know, your memories, your upbringing in Mosul. Can you tell us more about what you remember, what it was like growing up there?
I was born in 1959 in Mosul to a well-established family. My father was a pharmacist. We led normal life. We were well off, me and my friend. This photo actually from the area where my house used to be, a little bit to the left, is called Al-Ghabat, which means the forest area. And this photo was taken from a hotel called Oprah Hotel, which was destroyed. In 1979, I finished my high school, and my father was, his dream was for me to become an engineer. So he said, why don't you travel to England to get your engineering degree? So I traveled to England, studied for 6 years for an English course, and then I started a course to get me into university. And then in 1980, my uncle here in the United States asked me, he said, why didn't you come to the United States? So he sent me an application, I filled it and I was accepted. So I came to Ann Arbor, Michigan. I was there for like 3 years, and then I decided to switch major. I was doing computer science, which I was not doing very well actually at that time. So I decided to go into industrial engineering because that was my father's wish for me to be an engineer. So I moved to Western Michigan University in 1984, and then I was there until winter of that in 1988, where I graduated. The picture is of my house in Al Ghabat area. We took us about 3 years to build my house and my brother's house. And we moved in 1989 or 1999. These are pictures of my wife, Mayada, to the left. Below is my daughter, Tuqa. Right in the right, my brother, Muhammad, who was an assistant professor at the University of Mosul. And my nephew is 17 years old, Najib. This was our every Friday ritual. My parents will come into our house and we will do the barbecue. And we had a really about 4 acre farm. And we just enjoy the good weather and do barbecuing. And usually Najib would do the barbecuing because he was becoming older. And since my son Yahya, I asked him to leave Mosul immediately after ISIS entered Mosul. I was afraid for his safety. And my other nephew, Abdullah, he was also asked to leave with his wife to Baghdad. So the only younger we had left was my daughter, Tuqa, and my nephew, Najib, and he will do the barbecuing.
So Basim, what was it like? Let's just backtrack a little bit to when you returned in 1988. You come back to Mosul after those 8 years in the United States. What was the country like then?
Well, actually, my first visit was in 1984, but it was only for 1 month. Then I came back. In 1984, as you remember, the Iran-Iraq War, which mm-hmm. took place for like 8 years, everything has changed financially, socially. The country was in a mess. People have their brothers, sisters, brothers, fathers, probably in the army for years. Many families lost their loved ones in the eight-year war. So everything has changed. Life was very, very difficult. And I remember I talked to one of my friends my first time on the street. I said, I don't see any face laughing. Mm. He said, well, Basim, don't blame them. They have been facing this situation of war for 8 years. So it was really sad to see all of my friends. I lost many of my friends in that war. So when I returned to Iraq, after a month, I was drafted in the army. But I was in the Army Corps of Engineers in a battalion north of Iraq in a city called Erbil, which was pretty safe. When the 1991 war with Kuwait, I was in the army, but I really did not see any fighting. I was in a safe place at that time.
And in 2003, when the Americans came to Iraq, what do you remember about that time?
Well, 2003, the first was Baghdad, of course. And the American army did not come to Mosul until like a few days later. And my first encounter with an American soldier was with my father and I were going to his pharmacy. And a Humvee was there with two soldiers, very strange feeling, somebody foreign on your soil. The guys were very polite, and actually for the first 3 months there was no problem with the American mm-hmm. army because they were safe, they felt safe. Actually, the people who did not serve in Mosul, they used to come to Mosul and to Erbil and to Duhok to spend their leave because it was very safe. Until 3-4 months later when everything started to change, mm-hmm. the resistance started and everything went into shambles. Yeah.
So it's now 2014, June. ISIS has taken over Fallujah and comes into Mosul. How did life change for your family?
Well, in June of 2014, this was not the first time we never called them ISIS before. Mm-hmm. Then we would call them like resistance or insurgents or mujahideen. We've never heard the term ISIS before. Mm. So it had happened before. They have, for the like a year or two before, they have entered Mosul from that certain area from the west. They will be in the city for 2-3 days. A curfew will be enforced, and then they will be fought out of the city. Mm. But during the last attack on Mosul, everything changed. We had about 50,000 soldiers in arm. We had about 10,000 police force. and everybody left their position. And I lived on the east side of Mosul. They entered through the west side, and in 2 days they crossed the rivers, and I can see them in front of me, wearing Afghani, 300
like
Afghan style, yeah, clothes, tunics, yeah. It was very strange. I've never seen them before, and we knew this time it was different, not mm-hmm. like every time, because the army, they just left Mosul.
So, describe sort of the ways in which your daily life changed as a family and how you guys coped.
Okay, for the first month or two, they did not meddle in our life, mm-hmm. but...
unless you were a member of the police.
Unless you were a member, yeah. If I actually, I lost five of my friends. Three of them were ex-army officers. They were arrested and killed. I had two of my friends who were nominees for a city council election. They were arrested and killed. So most of the people who worked in the government, they fled Mosul. Mm-hmm. All Christians who lived in Mosul fled Mosul immediately. Mm-hmm. So after a year, a month or two, everything has started. The first thing they did was they started enforcing that men have to grow beards. Mm-hmm. And then a month later, for the women, they have to wear the niqab, the veil and everything. And then they forced us to close our shops at every prayer time, which is something we have never done before. Mm-hmm. And then they started interfering with everything. I mean, they will come to your, like you're walking in the street, and if they don't like the way you dress, or if they don't like the way your hair cut, just like what happened with Najib.
So what happened with your nephew Najib?
My nephew Najib, this is Najib, he was 17 at that time. Because we stopped them from going to school, because we were afraid that they would be brainwashed by ISIS because they were controlling the schools, we stopped sending our kids to schools. My daughter Tuqa and Najib. Tuqa was the last year high school, and Najib was like 2 years to finish high school. So he would come to us, with us to my pharmacy or his grandfather's pharmacy. So I was sitting around 11 a.m. when Najib entered my pharmacy and have shaved his head. So I just hugged him and he was crying. I said, what happened? He said, well, he was wearing a t-shirt with English writing. They arrested him for that. They said, well, you are wearing imperialist clothes. So they shaved his head and they gave him 10 whiplashes. So I just hugged him. I took him to the back of my pharmacy. I washed his face. I said, don't cry. I sent for somebody to bring him a hat to cover his head because he was ashamed to walk that way. So I bought him a hat for him to cover his head, and I just took him home. And then he stayed home for about 2 months. He refuses to leave home because he had to shave all of his head just to correct what they did to him. And that was one of the things that I said, one of the minute things.
Yeah. So I would go through some of Najib's Facebook posts, and you know, he would often post that he was lonely, that he was sad, his family, one of his best friends, Qasim,
his cousin, because we stopped them from going out, we were really afraid of for them. So this is his brother's camera. He took a photography, and he used to photograph mini cars, and you remember how he posted the pictures of the mini cars, and they would just text him and his cousin. So he either go to his cousin's house for a few days, or his cousin would come to our house and spend a week with us. We were really scared for them to go out. And he was very lonely and upset. Yeah.
Yeah. And we sort of saw some images of food earlier. How did you guys cope together at home? Like were your homes a refuge against ISIS? What was sort of the means through which you all got by?
Our daily routine changed. I myself used to stay out at 10, 11 at night, but then because of them on the street and that, they will just stop me for the silliest thing. So I decided every day just to come home by 5, mm-hmm. and I stay at home. And because we had a really large farm and we had a swimming pool, and so many of my friends They would just come over and visit. And it was like a haven for them. Mm. We had big land, we had the swimming pool, and we just do barbecue, and they would leave at night.
So what happened on September 20th, 2015?
September 20th, I just came home about 5, my regular hours. It was a hot day. I just had lunch. I took a nap for like half an hour. And then my usually routine, just have dinner about 7, watch some TV. And my late wife, Mayada, she usually goes to bed around 10. She's an early riser. So she went to bed around 10. So I stayed me and took off watching TV. And then took off, she went to bed around 11. So I turned off the TV. I went on my desktop. Just went through some Facebook, and I used to watch some car reviews on YouTube. And I went to bed around 12:30. I just checked on Tuqa, covered her, and went to bed. In the middle of the night, I woke up to an explosion that I cannot explain. A deafening sound. The smell was awful. And for a few seconds, I thought I was having a nightmare, really. So I just looked around, and everything was dark. Power went out. So I tried to get up. I looked at my left. My other was sleeping to the left. And all I see was debris. I tried to get up, but I fell down. I knew there was something wrong with me. I did not know at the beginning what it was. But I knew my left foot was broken. And then I felt my back was warm. I touched my back and I looked, and I smelled, I think it was blood. My back was injured, I was bleeding. And we had the farm, at the farm, we had another house for the groundkeeper. It's about 300, 400 feet from my house. You saw the house, Azmat. And I couldn't hear his voice. At that time, my sister-in-law, because of the explosion, she was thrown off the second story bedroom. And I could see her walk, and I was shouting at her. She said, what's happened? I said, we've been bombed. Yeah.
So the video I showed you earlier is actually Basim's home. And so what it didn't show was what were the homes of him and his brother, Mohamed. What it didn't show were the images you're seeing now. It didn't show Tuqa.
That was my daughter Tuqa a day before the bombing. She found this firework, and she was playing with it, and I was asking her to go out because it's dangerous, but she said, no, I'm okay, I'm okay. That was exactly a day before the bombing.
So as you eventually escape ISIS territory, you're badly injured, you go to Turkey, and what's sort of going through your mind as you're trying to make sense of what happened?
Well, it took me a month to be able to get out of Mosul after getting permission from ISIS. I drove to Turkey through Raqqa, Syria, and I was actually smuggled to there because I did not have a passport, but I had permission to enter from high authority in Ankara, and then I went through. During my travel in the car, I left Mosul about 9, arrived Raqqa about 5 p.m., and then reached Turkey the next day about 12. And I was just thinking in my head, what did we do? I mean, what prompted this attack on our houses? And I still have no answer. Why?
So Basim and I met in May of 2016. I'd been in Iraq for a few months then, looking into civilian deaths, looking into this anti-ISIS air campaign. And he had already by then gone to the US Embassy in Baghdad. He had come in with an 8-page report. He told a consular officer his story. And as he followed up with members of the State Department, who told him that they believed him, that his case was incredibly important to him, he started getting these emails, these bounce backs, no answers, no replies. And that's around the time that I met him. And I was invested not just in his case and what had happened, but so many other individuals who don't have the kind of resources, for example, to set up a meeting at the US Embassy or to smuggle themselves out of ISIS territory. But unlike all of the other cases that I'd been looking at then, there wasn't video evidence. The coalition hadn't put a video on YouTube that showed this exact house being hit. It's incredibly hard to get the government to admit that they carried out an airstrike unless you have a video that they uploaded. And so, you know, I set out with my reporting partner, Anand Gopal, we set out to do a systematic sample. We set out not just to look at those airstrikes that resulted in civilian deaths, but also to understand which ones didn't and why. And you know, we wondered whether we could do, you know, surveys in as many towns as possible. And what wound up happening is that we were able to do this in three towns. We were able to do this in the Aden district of East Mosul, which is a densely populated urban area. We were able to do it in Shoura, which is a small town, very typical of the kinds of small settlements that ISIS takes over, and in downtown Kayara, which is a suburban municipality about mid-sized. It's representative of the kinds of places that are taken over by ISIS and were besieged by airstrikes. But in many ways, it's also probably an underrepresented sample of civilian deaths. It does not include West Mosul, where the likelihood of civilian death is highest, nor does it include Anbar in the south, where intelligence and tribal networks that were feeding into these airstrikes were not as good as in these areas. And so you're probably looking at not just strikes that were more precise than others that fell in the country, but also those which occurred before a rule change in what kind of airstrikes could be carried out. And I just briefly want to show you some of the images of some of these airstrikes, because you know what the story that Basim is able to share is incredibly powerful, and it's not alone. This is what the findings show. So a sample of 103 airstrikes in those three towns showed, for example, in this case, what had been the railroad tracks in downtown Kayara, where ISIS had held a mortar but moved it a week before this airstrike hit, killing two families living in two homes. The lone survivor is this young girl named Rawa. This is the family of Rafael Araki. They lived in East Mosul, and you know, Basim had heard of them as well. Rafael Araki's wife, you know, one day ISIS burst into their house, demanded cell phones. Rafael Araki's daughter on the right-hand corner, you know, the family denied that they had cell phones because ISIS did not permit civilians to have them. They feared civilians would call in airstrikes or report on ISIS. But the little girl, who didn't know better, just burst into tears and produced her mother's phone. Her mother's phone had text messages between her and her sister who lived in Baghdad, in which she had said some derogatory things about ISIS. ISIS arrested both Rafi and his wife. You know, he was released a week later, and she wasn't. They said, we'll bring her to you. And just a few days later, they sent home her bullet-riddled body. Almost a year from that date, Rafi's house was hit along with two other civilian homes on each side of it, by an airstrike, a coalition airstrike that resulted in the deaths of 18 civilians. These are the parents of Ahmed al-Layla. Muhammad Tayyab al-Layla was a very prominent social mechanics scientist. His wife was a prominent gynecologist in Mosul. Ahmed al-Layla, their son, who ran the biggest Apple store
in Mosul. Yeah.
Yeah, you knew his family members.
Yes, with the other
distant relatives.
Yeah.
The father refused to leave Mosul. He said, look, I have my library, and I will not let those barbarians take my books. When ISIS would move into towns, they would often confiscate the houses of anyone who left and then distribute them. So if you left, your house was no longer your house. And he'd amassed this incredible collection of books. He refused to leave, and so they stayed in Mosul. And Ahmed al-Layla, who had left for Erbil, was texting his family as the war to retake Mosul had really intensified, and he stopped getting answers one day. And he learned, he sent out a message on Facebook. He said, look, if anybody can help, my family is in this house. Please check in on them. You know, he watched TV because the family was well known. There was a message that said, they're safe. The family is safe. And then he gets a phone call from a neighbor who says, "No, I'm sorry, brother, the entire house was destroyed." He watched it play out on television and on Facebook. This is a family that had lived next to a house that ISIS had taken over. ISIS left. A few minutes later, the house and the house next door were bombed and 6 civilians were killed. These are just children who live in the neighborhood who actually play in that rubble. This is a man whose house was hit, but his family lived. ISIS had moved in next door. And Basim, I'm sure you can describe in great detail about, you know, how ISIS ingratiated itself in the local population.
Yeah, what happened was when they come to a neighborhood, just like months before the liberation of the city, like if they come to a street with 7 houses, they force the dwellers of that house to open holes in the walls between the neighbors so they can go back and forth inside the houses. And then sometimes they force like every 3 to 4 families to live in one house. And they will be on the rooftops. And a friend of mine, Muhammad, you met him, he had ISIS, they were in the basement, and ISIS were on top of his roof. And he asked them, said, "Can I leave my house, please?" I said, "No, if we die, you die with us." So they refused him to leave, but then somebody said, "Okay, you can go." So they let him go. During the liberation of Mosul, I feel that there was an extreme use of force. You have a building. We had an office building downtown Mosul, and it was bombed and later demolished. Many houses with people living, 10, 20 family members, and one ISIS member goes to the roof, and the whole house is bombed. This is, to me, as an extreme use of force. My friends in Mosul have told me about precise bombing, like for a vehicle with one ISIS member, and they will hit that vehicle without even hurting the vehicle next to it. So why was one person on a rooftop not hit in this kind of weaponry? Why demolish the whole house and kill so many innocent civilians?
Sometimes, you know, these airstrikes would not result in a civilian death. This is an example in downtown Kayara. It was a water sanitation facility that had been taken over by ISIS. They stored explosives there, and it was hit at night. No civilians died in these airstrikes, but it's, you know, an example of the ones that were, that achieved their intended result. But I show you this just to give you a grand picture of what the overall sample showed. And so in addition to mapping each site of airstrike in all of those 3 areas, one of the things that I also did was to determine areas that ISIS had taken over. And Basim just described, you know, the sort of means through which that ISIS had confiscated homes, businesses, taken over large parts of the city. And you can see here that they were, you know, in downtown Kayara operating prisons, you know, turning regular homes into prisons, things that look like civilian residences into what were very clearly ISIS targets. And the reason why it was important to map these out as well is to determine in those cases where civilians were killed, was there a legitimate target nearby, according to the military's own rationale, what may have happened. And this level of detail is not it's not my job as a reporter to tell you whether an airstrike is correct or not, but it was to try to determine what may have gone wrong and why, because that's often the question that's missing. And what we found was that even though the military's numbers at the time in Iraq had said that suggested that 1 in every 157 airstrikes resulted in a civilian death, we found on the ground that 1 in 5 resulted in a civilian death. Just to give you a sense of the difference in magnitude, earlier I talked about 0.6%, less than 1%, according to the government's numbers. What we found was 31 times higher. Not twice as high, not 3 times as high, 31 times as higher, and these numbers are likely conservative. We also found incomplete logs. You know, we would turn in the GPS coordinates and dates of an airstrike, they would do an assessment and tell us whether or not they had conducted it. In some cases, they said, very unlikely, you know, the nearest airstrike we conducted was 600 meters away. And then I would find videos of those airstrikes that they had conducted in the areas that we had pointed out. And the reason why this matters is because the number one reason the US-led coalition cites when it denies an allegation of civilian casualty is that it has no record of carrying out an airstrike on that geographic area. Someone like Basim was able to get proof and response because there was a video. Those videos, only maybe a small fraction of videos of airstrikes have ever been made public. It's rare to be able to show that, but what we found was that in many cases, the United States government and the US-led coalition was unable to identify its own airstrikes, thereby calling into question whether it could even assess accurately these civilian casualties. We also found that while the military often cites as the reason for airstrikes, what's traditionally called collateral damage or proximity, right? Hitting a target that was intended and there happened to be a civilian nearby, or hitting an ISIS target that resulted in secondary explosions because they were bombings. That's traditionally what the government cites when it does identify a reason for civilian casualty. We found that in half the cases of civilian deaths that we encountered on the ground, and half of them were either the result of poor or outdated intelligence. So they either conflated civilians with combatants or an ISIS target had left the area.
Actually, Azmat, the acceptable kill ratio was 1 to 30.
1 to 30.
30 civilians are okay to be killed to get one ISIS. I found this out lately.
Yeah.
So this is an acceptable ratio.
So there is a ratio that the government uses.
Yeah, this is.
It's called an NCV rate.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the number of civilians that are allowed to be killed before a strike has to be approved by a higher authority. This is the case for these deliberately long-term planned strikes. The numbers change based on where the point of battle is. The numbers are classified, so you can't get the government to tell you what that number is. Many have suggested that at periods of time in Mosul, it was as high as 10. But there's no way to even know.
No.
There is no way to know except...
During the campaign to liberate Mosul, bombing actually changed because it became more mobile. So mm-hmm. the person on the ground, he has direct contact to the drone or whatever. And before you had to assess, like my case, mm-hmm. they had aerial surveillance. Mm-hmm. But later, any target given by ground group bombed immediately.
That's the December 2016 directive I mentioned when the rule change happened.
Yeah.
More people on the ground could call in airstrikes. And so there is a number that they have that is acceptable. And other governments may not use that same number. So, you know, some British governments may say zero. It depends on the particular situation. But one of the efforts of our investigation was to find out
the report we received.
Why our homes were targeted.
Yeah.
And through FOIA, we got it. Can you kind of take us through?
After months of back and forth and emails, Azmat was able, they said, okay, we finished the investigation, but we needed to be declassified. And one of the things I asked my first meeting with the embassy staff, said, at first, I need to clear my name, because right now I'm considered to be ISIS, and this is very important to me. I need to clear my name. Second, I need compensation for what you did to me. So I have never received a specific letter to clear my name up to the day today. They released this report, and everything is blacked out. You cannot see anything. Really?
Yeah.
So this is the declassification.
Yeah. Mm. So what? Just to give you a sort of sample of what information was in there. It was largely redacted. So the human intelligence, if there was human intelligence used, that was redacted. So you don't know who called for what. But the coalition reported that it had intelligence on two houses that were in ISIS command center. They said that maybe the houses were confused with a government building next door. Next, according to the report, the coalition dispatched a drone to surveil the property. Over 3 days, in 15 to 30 minute windows, these houses were filmed. Now, this report mentioned that no overtly nefarious activity was observed, but nonetheless, everything the coalition witnessed, according to this drone footage they wrote, confirmed its conviction that it was filming a terrorist headquarters. No weapons were visible, but they reported that ISIS does not obviously brandish weapons so as to go undetected. Occasionally, Basim or Mohammed would open the gate to their homes, the shared gate to the street. The coalition simply saw men opening a gate, an action that it determined was consistent with the activity of an ISIS headquarters. And perhaps most importantly, the report stated that the coalition did not observe the presence of any women or children outdoors, even though in ISIS-held territory, women are unlikely to go out because
exactly.
of the rules.
Exactly, yeah, and then we argued that the surveillance was done during the day, around 12 to
during
4,
the
during daytime,
yeah.
In a very hot weather, so there's no way we will go out in like 120 degrees temperature. So we argued with them, if you had done surveillance during the night, you will see two families sitting out in the lawn, having coffee, tea, or whatever. So, yeah, the surveillance was inaccurate and incomplete.
So even though the Razzo family didn't know it, the burden of proof was on them to prove that they were civilians. And in the end, just 95 minutes of completely unremarkable footage sealed their fate. Basim doesn't have an answer. He doesn't know the precise reason. He doesn't know the alleged human or signals intelligence that could have been used. What he knows is that 95 minutes sealed his fate. What I also learned was that this airstrike was what's known as a deliberate airstrike. It was planned over a period of weeks and months, not a dynamic airstrike that's planned within minutes or hours, or possibly a day, depending on the situation. 80% of the coalition's airstrikes in this anti-ISIS air war have been those planned over minutes and hours, 80% of them. That means that 80% of them did not have the kind of footage that we're talking about here. This case that we're talking about right now is a very best case scenario of the kind of surveillance that's used in many of these airstrikes when you compare them with those that are dynamic. So this example is one that is supposed to meet some of the highest thresholds.
Mm-hmm.
And the report itself stated that, you know, none of the laws of wars were violated. There was no evidence indicating carelessness or bad faith, and that the targeting process remains sound. It also noted that because of an equipment error, the drone footage no longer existed for review. So as you read this, Basim, what were you thinking?
I don't know, because after I submitted my report in a few days, the video, which was on YouTube, was removed. Yeah, and
not after you submitted your report.
No,
that was after
you started talking to them.
Yeah,
they removed the video from YouTube, and then for some reason the footage was, I don't know, for some technical reason, they said the footage was deleted, and we still don't have any clear idea why. When I met the lawyer, when she came to Erbil, I specifically asked her.
Just to give you a quick sense
before
this lawyer, the United States has provisions for paying civilians for deaths that are the result of U.S. airstrikes or military combat operations. Congress has authorized at least $5 million every year for this purpose. The U.S. hadn't paid a single Iraqi or Syrian for a death since it started this in August of 2014. The first time they made an offer was on March 17th, 2017, to Basim. And this is when he went to Erbil to meet the lawyer, the military lawyer he just mentioned.
Yeah, I received an email from a lawyer from the DOD, and she said, we'd like to meet you. Anand was in Erbil, and we arranged to go to the American Air Base in Erbil Airport. So I was met by three lawyers, one lady and two gentlemen. She said, we are so sorry. I'm apologizing in the name of the American Army. And we are here to make you an offer. They call it a solatia payment. This is in no way compensation for the loss of your house or anything. And so she gave me $15,000 for the death of my wife and my daughter.
She offered $15,000,
which was equivalent.
What did you estimate? What did you estimate the cost of just the home, not even the deaths of your loved one?
For just for my house, just for rebuilding, I showed you the estimate now. It's about $400,000. This is just for the rebuilding, not talking about all the material inside, all the memories. I lost my laptop, I lost my desktop, I had the photos of our entire life on that computer. Everything was lost, in addition to the loss, which is more important, of family members. Everything can be rebuilt, except the loss of life. This cannot be undone. So I laughed. He said, "Why are you laughing?" I said, "Excuse me for refusing, but I think this is ridiculous." And then she said, "Well, I'm sorry, but we are tapped off." That was her exact words. "This is the maximum amount that we can offer you." Tapped off.
Capped off.
And so we ended the meeting, and we left. Me and Alan, we left. And before we left, I said, "I need two things from you. First, I need the letter." She said, "I promise you, I will get it to you in 2 days." And then I asked her, "I need another thing from you. My property is still considered ISIS territory. Please, the army is rampaging my farm, and we have many stores in that farm. My nephew Abdullah, he had a shop. He used to import things from Turkey, and when he closed the shop, he brought thousands of dollars of worth of material. I said, please, I want you to stop the Iraqi or whoever coming into my farm to stop stealing my things." He said, "I promise you, I will get on the email right now. I will talk to the American commander on the ground. He will talk to the Iraqi commanders," and nothing happened. I never received the letter. And actually, for a month or two, they kept. Actually, I went. They would not let me in. I tried to go. After me and you, we went. JCC had returned. They refused for me to enter.
So we went back in the first time.
Yeah, this
you
was
were
my
to,
first
May of last year,
last
almost
year.
A year ago.
Yeah.
What was that like returning to?
Azmat was in Erbil, and the photographer from New York Times was coming. So that was my first trip. It was very emotional. It was my first time in Mosul to go to the farm. And the things I saw, I was, you know, after that, I only went once. And every time I drive, I try to take a different route so I don't go near my farm. It's an emotional wrecking for me. I just cannot go anymore. This was my kitchen, in fact.
What? These are just some images of some of the other civilian survivors that I met during that sample. I recently returned to Iraq in January and went back to many of them. I'd reported their cases to the military months before. None of them have received payment offers like Basim did. None of them have been contacted by the U.S. military or the coalition, even though we provided their contact information with their consent so they could be interviewed, so their testimonies could be taken. These cases haven't moved forward. And Basim, I wanted you, knowing you see this firsthand, right?
This is the first time I see it.
But you see that the civilians that you met who've undergone not just ISIS atrocities, but what is your goal?
After the campaign on ISIS, I mean, this is everyday thing we see on the paper, and my friends going into the ground. For me to get the courage to cross the river where the old city was, a 500, 600 years old city, which is devastated, completely destroyed. I believe there are still people under the rebels. I feel it's my responsibility because I have been able to reach out. It's my responsibility to be the spokesman of the thousands who have no way of reaching out and making their voices heard and cases published.
Basim arrived in New York two nights ago, and yesterday I gave him some options. We were thinking about going around New York about where we could maybe go, and one of them was the 9/11 memorial, and he said, I want to go there. And so yesterday, Basim, can you just kind of take us through what that experience was like for you?
Yeah, you know, I sympathize with this. I mean, it was a horrible act, and I feel so sorry. When I stood there and looking down at that wall,
blurry wall.
Believe me, Azmat, I could smell death. I'm so sorry for the life that was lost. Now I'm thinking, like the Americans, they built this museum and this memorial to remember the people who lost their lives at that attack. I'm thinking now of doing something on a smaller scale in Mosul to show the people what happened for that city. Mosul is a very peaceful city. Mosul was labeled, every person from Mosul was labeled as an ISIS. This is not true. We have lived with the Christians for thousands of years. Now I've lost all my Christian friends. Now my goal is to go back to Mosul, try to establish on a small scale an exhibition or a small museum to gather what happened in that city over the last 3 years. So for the next generations to see what happened in that city. And I will reach to the help of anybody who can help me. You know? This will be my next mission.
Thank you, Basim.
Thank you.
I want to open this up to questions. If you have questions for Basim, please just raise your hand and wait for the microphone before you ask them. But thank you, Basim. Just extraordinary.
I'm
so grateful to get to hear this. Are there any questions?
Thank you so much, both of you. Thank you, Basim, for coming here and reliving the story with us and sharing, and Azmat, for your relentless work making people heard. My question is, after living through this and after Azmat, your work seeing other people who went through similar cases, the question that I have is, do you think it is a matter of intelligence that could have done better, or the margin of error that could have been smaller, or do you think that there's something inherently problematic and complicated about the U.S. intervention during that time?
I personally feel it's a failed intelligence. There is no way it was wrongfully bombed. The precision is pinpoint. So it's definitely wrong ground information, intelligence.
Thank you for sharing your story.
Thank you.
Sorry you had to go over it again with us, so we're very grateful. So I'm from Pakistan, and I'm sure you can understand Pakistan also suffers from like drone strikes, and I'm sure there are many people in our northern area who can completely, you know, understand what you're going through. My question is, how much do you think the outcome could have been different if it wasn't drone technology that was used in like this kind of intervention? Because as you know, like with drones, there is no man-to-man person. There's someone sitting in another country thousands of miles away deciding like, oh, and we saw the view from the air, and it's not at all what it's like on the ground. So do you think if there was like an actual person, or like maybe in a plane, or like not that kind of technology in use, things could have been different?
Actually, the bombing, I don't think it was done by a drone, because the amount of the blast, there was no way it was caused by a rocket or a bomb by a drone, so it was done by a larger airplane. The footage for the surveillance was definitely done by a drone. And somebody told me that the drone center was like in Philadelphia or somewhere. So, yes, the drones are the cheaper way of bombing. Many drones were used before the liberation of Mosul, of targeting ISIS on motorcycles, in small cars, in boats. So it was cheaper to send a drone than to send an F-16 or an F-18. Yeah.
Basim, what was it like when the story came out? You weren't based in the U.S. at that time. What was it like to hear from people? How were you feeling? Were you relieved? Were you excited? Were you sad? I'd love to hear more about your emotions over the last few months.
The article was published. I was in Baghdad airport flying to Erbil, and Azma texted me. She said, the article is out. And Raya, my cousin, was coming from the United States, and I picked her up from Baghdad. And I was coming in the airport, so I downloaded it, and I was reading it. So my cousin's daughter Aisha, she was of course she's a faster reader than I am. So she read the whole story, and she was sitting in the seat like behind me, and I looked at her and she was crying. She said, "Ammu Basim, don't read it now." So I did not read it until I got to Erbil. That was about 2 a.m. So I read it before I went to bed. It was beautiful piece. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing your story. Yeah. I wanted to get your thoughts sort of on next steps, concrete steps right now. I know you've talked about wanting to establish a memorial to sort of commemorate this loss of civilian life, but just individually, for yourself, what do you want now?
Well, for me now, my son is somewhere, my nephew is somewhere, my mother is somewhere, my sister-in-law. We have never lived in a rented house. We have never lived. All my family now are in rented houses. So I need compensation to rebuild houses for my son, my nephew, for them to, in their own houses, for them to grow their families, for me to be around them, watching over them. Like I told you, I am the spokesman of the silent majority of Muslims. Yeah. So I'm thinking of this memorial. This came yesterday after we visited the museum, and I found how much the Americans they did for the dead. I really do need to do something for our deaf people, for the youth to come, like in 10, 20 years to come. ISIS was, I have no words to describe them. And I want their memory to live in the minds of the next generation so they can avoid being drawn into their ideas.
Please.
How are you doing? I just want to offer my condolences for everything you suffered
and
all the losses you've had. And I also want to express how grateful I am to have an opportunity to listen to you guys today, because it's truly tremendous and courageous efforts, even to just everything that you've gone through, and for you to put yourself forward and try to make a strong difference and, you know, enlighten everyone here. Having said that, in terms of the $5 million that were allocated to be distributed towards people who have suffered, I was wondering if those funds have not been used, have they remained unused? Was there any investigation as to what has happened with it? And has the U.S. military made any comments on that?
Yeah, so those funds have never been used. They have been authorized through Congress. So the military has the option of using this money for this purpose. It has never exercised that authority. Even the payment offer that was made to Basim came from a miscellaneous, like, operations and maintenance budget. It didn't even come from that $5 million. You know, part of our reporting involved questioning not just these payments and the sort of allocated amounts, these measures, the average sort of $2,500 per death, but just in general, is the U.S. military or even the State Department going to be involved in using some of the provisions on the books? There's still a State Department-related provision as well for the victims, civilian victims of wars. The State Department couldn't answer whether this law on the books, this allocation of money for that purposes, could be used towards civilian survivors of U.S. combat operations. The military said it's focusing its efforts on rebuilding and reconstruction, and they're really not going to. You know, earlier they had told me, I think, you know, we can't access those areas right now, so, you know, it's really difficult for us to make those payments. It's not, you know, there's no ill will towards those payments. There's nothing stopping us from doing them in terms of our intentions. But when it came time, when they do have access to those areas, you know, they told us we're focused elsewhere right now. So this really depends just based on the history of when payments have been made, the history of when the military has been accountable to its own rules. You look at that history, you'll see that that accountability is triggered when the public cares or demands it. And for many, when you look at what is a shift to air war, most Americans aren't familiar with the fact that we're even at war in Iraq and Syria. And you see that in the debate over, you know, should we strike Assad targets, the Assad regime targets in Syria? That debate acted as though we hadn't been at war for several years, dropping 106,000 bombs in Iraq and Syria. And so many Americans aren't even familiar with it. What's been your perception in talking to some of the Americans that you have about awareness of this war?
Yeah, many. I was at Penn State University for a week. I talked to two or three classes of 750 students, and many of them, they have no idea of what's happening. Very few are familiar with what's happening in Iraq, what's happening in Syria, and the danger of going to war again. And I always talk to students. I've been doing my talk with the Penn State University class, Sociology 119, for 6 years. And I always, my final word to them is, please reach out, go beyond your borders, know that there are people who have needs and dreams, just like you do, and empathize with them. And if you empathize, I think you won't do harm to anybody.
Any last question? Yeah.
First of all, I want to echo condolences and gratitude for your grace.
Thank you, sir.
Are there any remedies in U.S. courts? Is that being explored at all?
Well, actually, I have a lawyer currently who's investigating.
That
avenues.
Was one of the outcomes of the story, right?
Outcomes of the, yeah, a lawyer contacted me from a firm in D.C., and he offered to take my case pro bono. And we are on almost weekly contact, and he's arranging some meetings for me with a senator in D.C. in 2 weeks. So he is exploring avenues of what to do, but nothing concrete. He has not promised anything. We just need to do what we need to do and see where we go.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Fantastic. So please join me in thanking Basim and Azmat.
Thank you so much.
We really appreciate you being here. We'd like to carry on the conversation in the atrium. We have food, we have drinks. I know Basim is enthusiastic about meeting people, so please come say hi and let's share in some conversation together. Thank you.
Thank you.